Golam Mafuz, he's the speaker from IIT Mumbai. He will talk about this perturbations in quadratic gravity of inflation. And yeah, like during the talk, anybody can stop him and ask as many as question if you can't able to understand. So there is no restriction. So Mafuz, you are there?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah.
And it is request to all other listeners, those who are attending the meeting, please switch off your microphone so that he can only speak. So I can see that Shaptoki's microphone is switched on. So please switch off the microphone, please. And if I ask anything, then you will like switch on the microphone. If the same thing goes for Anik also. So all the people who are attending this meeting, please switch off the microphone and only the speaker don't do that, because if he switched off, then we can't able to listen to him. So you can hear everything, I hope so. Mafuz, say something.
Yeah, I can hear. I'm ready to start.
No, wait.
Yeah.
All the people, one by one, just tell me you can able to hear Mafuz or not.
Yeah, I can hear.
I can hear him.
Okay. Shaptoki?
I can hear him. I can hear him, sir.
Amader?
Yes, sir, I can hear.
So everybody, I think, can able to hear.
I can also hear, yeah.
Yeah. So please start.
Okay, good evening to everyone. Today, I'm going to talk about...
Speak loudly.
Okay. Today, I'm going to talk about effective energy momentum tensor of cosmological perturbations in R plus alpha R square model of inflation.
Achha, my first question.
Okay.
My first question is, why R plus alpha R square? What alpha means?
Alpha is a constant here.
Okay. By why you have introduced a parameter here?
I never thought about that, but because most of the papers...
most of the forget about the papers. What is the dimension of R? What is the mass dimension of R?
What is the mass dimension of R?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mass dimension is
the
square, right? 2. Mass dimension is 2. 2. So R
square
is 4.
Yeah.
So then R is basically a dimensionless constant. Dimensionless. So you should write something called Md square R plus alpha R square. That's why I'm asking. Because whatever you have written, it is dimensionally inconsistent.
Okay.
Md square R is mass dimension 4.
Okay.
So you have to write Md square R plus alpha R square. Then the whole thing is mass dimension 4. And D4X is mass dimension minus 4. That's why your action is dimensionless.
Okay.
You have to be very consistent. I will ask like that. Each and every point I will ask. Okay, now proceed.
Yeah. So, these are the top.
No, don't scroll your screen. There is something called presentation in the PDF. You just open the full screen mode.
Okay.
Yeah, now
present slide screen.
Yeah, that's the
okay?
Yeah, yeah. Proceed, proceed.
Yeah. So the first, I will talk about why we are considering about this modified gravity models, this so-called R plus or whatever. Sayantanda told that MP R plus alpha R square.
There is no Sayantanda, only sir.
Okay. Sir told as MP R plus alpha R square model of inflation. So after the motivation, I will briefly discuss about inflation. The idea of inflation mostly related to the horizon problem. I mean, how the inflation solves the horizon problem, which is the standard model is plagued with. And after that, briefly discussing about inflation, we will get into the mathematical tools of cosmological perturbations theory. And then we will go on to discuss about effective energy momentum tensor of the of these perturbations. So actually,
no, I will. We have one question again. So, like Einstein gravity is quite successful to explain a lot of things.
Yeah.
But like once you go to the modified gravity, okay, which is like you are modifying the Einstein gravity R with some additional term alpha R square, which is a quadratic term. Okay. So okay, in principle, you can add infinite number of terms because this is you are doing a perturbation theory. So if you add infinite number of terms, as the mass dimension grows, it will be suppressed accordingly with respect to the Planck scale. Okay, if you add higher terms, if it is like mass dimension 12, then you have to suppress it by MP to the power 8. Okay, then the total mass dimension is 4. Okay, so like if you go for higher terms, then you will see that the terms are basically convergent, not it is a divergent. So that's why the perturbation expansion valid in this particular area below the Planck scale. Okay, now the problem is I'm asking why particularly R square? Is there any motivation of doing R square particularly? You will talk about that probably, na? You will mention, I think.
One of the things I think.
If you are discussing that thing later, just proceed. I will ask accordingly. Just proceed and I will ask accordingly.
Okay.
But you have to explain this, why R square? Because you can add R cube, you can add R to the power 4. Okay, so why particularly R square? What is the speciality of R square? You have to tell us. Okay.
I can, I have not included that one in this presentation, but if you ask,
so there comes, tell about that. It's very important, actually.
Okay. So, I think the answer to your questions is that all of the features, like the any theories of higher derivative gravity theories, this is the simplest one to study. Okay.
That is a vague reason. That is a vague reason. Anything simplest, so you can study. But I'm asking, what is the physical motivation? That's the thing you are explaining. I can able to understand that. Oh, that the problem you were discussing, you can't able to handle that thing. It's very complicated if you include the higher order terms and all. So it's, I can understand, but I'm asking that what is the physical motivation? Why particularly R square?
Why only R square? Why not R cube? Okay. So, I don't think, so can you please explain it? I'm not sure about it.
Think about that. I will explain, but think about that later. It's one of the good questions people can ask.
Okay.
That means I'm asking you why Starobinsky model is important. Simple.
It provides us with the, I mean, the scale invariant power spectrum as we see it in
scale invariant power spectrum. Those things only you able to get if you do the perturbations. And before doing the perturbations, what is the motivation? Because r plus alpha r square, this is a gravity theory. This is not invented by Alexis Starobinsky. Alexis Starobinsky's contribution is his theory is quite simple. He said that, oh, in my theory, there is no matter degrees of freedom. I have written the action in the Jordan frame. Now, I will do a conformal transformation in the metric from Jordan to Einstein frame. That still actually makes the complicated quadratic gravity to the Einstein theory. So in the Einstein frame, you will get r instead of r plus r square. Okay. But additionally, due to this conformal transformation, you will get an additional scalar field with an effective potential and kinetic term. Okay. Now, this effective potential is basically kind of some exponential potential. Okay. And this scalar field, whatever you are saying, scale invariant, whatever power spectrum, so it contains those features. Okay. But like in Jordan frame, there is no matter. Okay. But in Einstein frame, you are getting the matter due to this conformal transformation, and this conformal transformation, this conformal factor is acting as dilaton, or something some people used to call it scalaron. Okay, so once you get the effective potential of that matter field, you call the scalaron effective potential or dilaton effective potential, whatever. But I'm asking that, forget about all these things, but like even if in Jordan frame, including r plus r square, what is it exactly it means? So think about that. I'm not asking to give the answer immediately, but think about that. These are very crucial questions.
One thing that is important here, that we can also add, I think, as far as I know, that we can also add some matter fields in the Jordan frame as well, right?
You can do whatever you want, but your theory has to be an effective theory when you are talking about the quantum, when you are talking about the perturbation. Okay, your perturbation is valid below the Planck scale, so that your effective theory description holds good up to Planck scale, and you can expand you can include as many as the terms you want to include in the theory. So all those are the higher order higher mass dimensional operators. But all those operators has to be suppressed by the cutoff scale of that gravity theory. So your cutoff scale is the Planck scale. So Planck scale suppressed operators you will get.
So actually, whatever constant here we are putting, that is specifying the scale of the theory.
Yeah, so here is the question. Particularly R square gravity scale independent gravity, invariant now. Scale independent, because alpha is mass dimension less. Alpha basically will not run with the background energy scale. Alpha is just a constant. Okay. But for other coefficients, if you include R cube, okay,
right.
The coefficient has to be mass dimension to the power minus 2, because R cube means 6.
Yeah.
So you have to decrease 2. So your coefficient is mass dimension minus 2. So, and so on. If you go more, you will see that your mass dimension is suppressed.
The
coefficient. So particularly R square gravity, if you look into the coefficient is dimensionless. So if you actually try to find out how the theory evolves with very high energy scale to the low energy scale, you will see that particular constant will not evolve with the background energy scale. In terms of quantum field theory, people used to call it the RG flow. There will not be any RG flow, particularly of that constant alpha. But for other constants, which we don't call it constant, which are basically parameter of the theory, for other operators, those parameters will basically vary with the background energy scale. That means participate in the renormalization group flow. Okay?
Okay.
So that's the main reason I want to ask.
Thank you for the explanation.
Next. Go to the next slide, please. Achha, anybody have any question related to whatever I have said?
Okay, I think there is no.
No.
Anybody, Orko, Anjon, anybody have any question? Whatever I have said regarding that issue?
No.
George, you are also there?
Yes, I'm here.
So probably George, I have explained yesterday this thing to you. I think that George was asking me the similar type of question, because he's actually working on the infinite derivative gravity. The low energy effective limit of the infinite derivative gravity is the Starobinsky model.
Okay.
So you just continue whatever you want to say.
Sir has already explained a lot. I mean, at least the background for considering in Starobinsky inflation even before entering the perturbation theory. So as we all know that a standard model of cosmology is like a very successful, extremely successful model in terms of.
What is standard model? Because people used to heard about standard model of particle physics, but then you please explain what is standard model of cosmology.
Standard model of cosmology, it assumes that we have two kinds of matter. One is the lambda CDM model. Is that okay? The dark energy component is given by the cosmological constant itself, and it has to introduce around 20% of dark energy of the total matter budget and some standard matter, and implement and supplemented with the inflationary universe. This is the as a whole, as a package, this theory is called standard model of cosmology, as we know.
Okay.
Yeah.
Proceed.
So the apart from what sir explained, there are other motivations we got from observations, like current accelerated expansion of the universe. We know from observations our universe is accelerating, expanding, and it's expanding is expansion is accelerated expansion. And there is a tantalizing motivation from the temperature fluctuations of the CMB that we have a very hot past, and it might be possible that we have evolved as I said earlier, that we need inflation. So I will discuss it earlier, that how the problems of the standard model is solved by the inflation, idea of inflation. So, but we don't know how the inflation actually originated. We have a theory, there are many theories of inflation, but we don't actually know what.
So you want to mean that initial condition for inflation?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, I'm not sure about it. I mean, scalar field models of inflation, are they theoretically motivated enough? I mean,
the problem is, even if it is theoretically motivated, this is highly degenerate. You have infinite number of models, and you don't know which model is good and which model is bad, because you don't have very rich data, because you don't know anything about the gravitational wave the primordial gravitational wave. You just know the upper bound. So if you don't know, then you really don't know which particular scale, energy scale, is responsible for inflation. So that's the main problem. And that's why the inflationary paradigm, along with not inflation, even the other paradigms also, like the bouncing scenario, everything, all these are degenerate. Like, you can put infinite number of models in a particular energy scale. So it's kind of a infinite, but the success is later. If you assume that, then actually in the later stages of the universe, you can actually distinguish many, many things, but may okay. not be at the starting point.
Okay. And the next
another important issue. People used to design the quantum field theory according to that, but even if these days people are including more theoretical motivations, one of the possible thing is quantum entanglement. So people used to say that if quantum entanglement present in the early universe, then that gives you the proper explanation of getting the large scale structure at the late time universe. Okay, so there are explanations. It is not just a vague statement. There are mathematical proofs. Okay, now the problem is they have said that these people, you can actually test all these signatures of quantum entanglement in terms of the hot and blue, hot and red, hot means red, and the cold means blue spots in cosmic microwave background spectrum. And if you can able to measure, then you can exactly comment on how much entanglement is contributed in the early universe. So that's the thing. It is not exactly related, whatever you are saying, but yeah, like these are the motivations people are including these days to study the early universe physics. Okay, just continue, please.
Yeah, so the last two points, I mean, the last speaker has already talked a lot about dark matter. So, and I think the last one, the motivations coming from high energy physics, sir has already discussed with many things. So let me continue to the next slide. Yeah. All right. So in this talk, we describe about the back reaction of cosmological perturbations in this model. So actually, what this back reaction means. So actually, we will see that I will explain later that you can quantify the back reaction in terms of effective energy momentum tensor. Okay. So actually, the basic question of this thesis is like, suppose I have some perturbations about some background, and so is there any effect of those background or of those perturbations on the background, on the evolution of the background itself? So this is the main topic. So what is the effect?
Isn't it those back reactions are very small?
Those
back reactions are small.
There are. Okay, people have worked. I can't hear you properly. Can you please?
I'm saying that numerically, as far as numerics is concerned, yeah. How much it is significant?
Yeah, I mean, it's not at this moment. It's not. We are not sure about it. I mean, how much it will be important numerically, at least in the early universe. But there are people have worked for the late time back reaction, and they have so most people, they don't believe it. I mean, they don't believe that the back reaction of the late time universe can drive the accelerated expansion of the universe. So I can comment about the back reaction at the late time, but I don't know about the, I mean, I think it might that, have like, some...
I have the question is like, in early universe, how much it is significant?
That was my topic. I mean, that was my whole topic, to understand this. I mean, I didn't do any numerical estimate till now, but yeah, I was.
Okay. Proceed.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anjan wants to say anything about that?
No, nothing for this time. I will ask.
Do you have any comment on back reaction particularly?
I don't really understand the term back reaction and how could it have affected the early universe scenario. But anyway, I think he is going to speak on it. So let's wait for some time and ask.
Okay.
Okay.
Proceed.
So this is the picture where it has explained that the horizon problem solved by the inflation has been explained. So we are getting, suppose we are getting CME photons.
As far as you were talking about inflation, so inflation is proposed not to solve only the horizon problem. There are a lot of other problems as well.
Other problems.
Why you are particularly talking about the horizon problem?
Because I'm whatever I have done is specially flat. There was no curvature included in this whatever I am doing. So that's why I excluded this curvature problem part. And
I just forgot. There is another one.
Entropy problem, right?
Entropy problem, and flatness problem. And causality constraints, which is the horizon problem. There are a few more, monopole problem also.
So actually they all have to do that. As long as you are considering the exponential expansion, the scale factor is having exponential expansion, then we can solve most of the problems. But so in the similar fashion, whatever I will discuss here.
Sir, you have taken from the Tarsi lectures in 2009 by Daniel Bauman, I think.
I have found one of the clearest discussion on this.
Can you be able to explain this picture properly to our listeners?
Yeah, I will try. So if you see the y-axis is the conformal time. If you do not want to think about conformal time, think it about time itself. And the horizon part is the distance part. It's the spatial part. So the main problem is that suppose we are considering patches from signals from different patches from our Hubble scale close to Hubble scale. So if you plot their geodesic, in this picture, so you will see that they all correspond to this small triangles you see there in the bottom part. Yes,
please switch off the microphone, exit the speaker. How many times I would Anik, Sarkozy, and the new guy who joined. Please switch off the microphone. Listen to
me.
Please continue.
So you can see from those little triangles in the bottom side. So they are actually causally disconnected.
Now it is okay.
So we don't have any explanation for this. They are coming from two opposite sides didn't have any chance to interact with each other, so let alone they thermalize. So how this temperature they are so homogeneous, I mean how they are so similar so why are finding this? So actually this so let me explain in terms of particle horizon. Yeah, so the maximum distance a photon can travel between initial time, suppose a photon have started at time t1 and we are just measuring it at so the measured time is tf, suppose we are measuring it right now. So the maximum distance traveled by the photon is given by the following equation. Okay, so if you see the standard Big Bang, from the standard Big Bang model, if you calculate this quantity, you will get zero. In the limit, the scale factor A tends to zero, you will get the contribution zero. So what it implies that, okay, fine. Once their causal distance, they will never interact. So how can we solve this problem? So it is, if we just think it just like we have a shrinking Hubble, this AH inverse, this thing is called Hubble radius. Okay, so if we think this co-moving Hubble radius was shrinking, was d dt of this quantity is negative, so this can actually solve the problem, and this can actually work interestingly, make this whole integral come to negative infinity. So what it means, if you go back to the earlier picture, that there this conformal time, this tau naught, so it will extend towards negative infinity. So what it means that if you now extend this isosceles triangle, so just extend this triangle, so they will interact with each other, means they have the chance to interact with each other. It's a bit, so do you understand? Does any, hello,
anybody have any question?
And this thing is a bit tricky, but yeah, and the main thing is Golam, that
can you, hello Hello.
Yeah, ask me.
Yeah, can you go through the argument again? I was not following it, so possibly I missed something. Okay, so, yeah. So yeah.
So suppose you have this little isosceles triangle, the field with yellow color. Okay. So these are little patches corresponding to those circles in the right hand side. Okay. So you even if you think intuitively, you can understand they have the maximum time traveled and they are diametrically different position, how they will interact, right?
Okay.
So you then go to the concept of particle horizon. So you know how it is defined, particle horizon.
Okay.
So yeah, so this is defined as the maximum possible distance, or whatever photon, the maximum possible distance it can travel in time. So so suppose we are considering a single photon from the this recombination era, right? So this whole integral will not, I mean, if you do the integral in the limit a tends to zero, I mean, you will see that this whole integral turn get to zero.
Okay.
So what it, I mean, it's not so clear from this equation. You have to think a little bit. Okay. So what it, I'm trying to say it as physical as possible. So what it means that if you do not think that the Hubble radius was shrinking in time of inflation, what that means that if that integral doesn't go to in minus infinity, they didn't have any chance to interact with each other, which means that they will be causally disconnected, right?
Okay.
Yeah. So once you put this condition on this quantity.
Sorry to stop you. So what is so special about the minus infinity and having the value of zero? So how will you try to discriminate between the two situations? I'm just asking because I'm still not getting the point somehow. Possibly. Since tau equals zero signifies physically something, I think, which has some relation with the causality.
Tau equal to zero means tau present time scale, the present universe. And tau minus infinity corresponds to the, like, around at the time of Big Bang or something like that.
I mean, it would be better if I had a blackboard, and I mean, it's a bit tricky.
There is nothing called tricky. You can actually, why you are going to this particle horizon, complicated definitions and all, you can just explain from the figure. That is like sufficient enough to explain the problem. Yeah.
Okay.
Why you are going to such mathematical thing and equations and all, well, like, just explain from the figure. This is sufficient enough. Just explain.
So if you see in the figure itself, that if you extend this this line to this tau naught to negative infinity, then this triangles they will intersect, so which means that they have a coinciding past. You just
okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah. So I'm moving on. I think it's.
Yeah. That's okay. Please go ahead.
So these are the it's very common. So that's why I'm just. These are the condition. If you just put this condition d dt of this ah inverse, this that we have a shrinking Hubble sphere, this actually implies that this a double dot is greater than zero. I mean, you can get from there. I mean, you have to do a little bit algebra, you will get that. Okay, for the accelerated expansion, we need this, the scale factor, double derivative of the scale factor should be greater than zero. And one of the thing is that it should possess a negative pressure. Okay. And we should have a slowly varying Hubble parameter. This Hubble parameter epsilon actually has to, we can, it is related to our measured quantities that are, it is like denoted as h dot by h square. So actually it measures the e fold of the expansion. So these are the conditions. There is nothing. So, hello?
What is e-fold?
E-fold is like, suppose universe is expanding in the inclusionary epoch. So, how many? Hello?
Explain. Yeah. We are listening.
How many cycles of, there's a definition, okay, so that's why I didn't put it here, I just put the conditions here. Okay, so if you ask me what is the, e fold, okay, then you have to go, suppose we have something, some initial scale factor, and after some time we are getting some scale factor, okay. So how many folds, how many times the inflation has been extended, that we measure by that by the e fold. Hello?
Okay, but this is not a good explanation, whatever you have said. Just proceed.
Okay. So this is the Lagrangian. This is the Lagrangian for the matrix for power. So here the Einstein-Hilbert action, if you see the dimension of f of r, what is the
dimension of f of r?
I mean, I'm not comfortable with this dimension thing. I mean, I have never quantum field theory or whatever. I mean,
if of r is mass dimension has to be 4. Otherwise, your action is dimension couldn't able to. It's.
I mean,
it's have to be mass dimension 4. Okay, you have written the f of r in such a way that f of r is dimensionless.
Okay.
Because you have taken 1 by 16 pi g outside. So your f of r is dimensionless. And why you didn't put any metric in the matter?
Metric is the d4x. Why didn't I put? Because there.
Yeah, L. Why there is no square root of g?
Here, this is the matter part, right?
So
and left side is coming from the radiation.
Where is your square root of minus g?
Square root of minus g, because this whole thing, square root of minus g into v4, this combination is this combination is remains invariant.
Invariant under what?
Under coordinate transformation. I mean, this whole thing remains invariant.
Ah, but you didn't put the square root of g, na? That's why I'm asking.
In the left, in the second term, right?
Yeah.
So second term, second term is actually.
See, d4x is not Lorentz invariant here. Here,
no.
Here, root g d4x is the tensor density.
Yes.
So you have to put that. Otherwise, your action is not invariant under Lorentz transformations. At least SO1,3.
I mean, the second term would contain one root g minus.
Square root of minus g. Yeah.
Minus. Okay. So it's my mistake, I think. Okay. So this is the matter field, and this is. So okay, fine. So adding the average action, with respect to the metric, we can.
Mafuz, your battery is low. You just charge it.
Okay. Yeah. So this is the field equation in f of r.
Okay.
One thing is to notice that the trace of the field equation in case of whatever sir was telling about, that we had one scalar field. So you can see that there is one more extra degree. Okay, because if you see the field equation in general relativity, so this trace equation, it doesn't give you any dynamical equation here. Even in the absence of matter, the right hand side t equals 0, you get a dynamical equation for this f. So f is a degree of new, this is an extra degree of freedom coming into the picture. Okay, so I will discuss modified Friedmann equations corresponding to the above field equations. You just put the values of those and calculate the geometric quantities, you will get those equations. And this is the continuity equation followed by a perfect fluid. Fine. So there is nothing. This is just to mention this. Right. So let's come into the let's discuss about cosmological perturbations in an inflationary universe. Okay. So someone was asking that how this back reaction, how this coming into the picture, he didn't understand. And so I think the if you see the first line, so if I have scalar field driven inflation, then actually what happens if you perturb the scalar field, which means that you are perturbing the energy momentum tensor corresponding to that field, right? And that field is related to the perturbations of the geometrical quantities, the delta g mu, the metric. In turn, this will perturb the scalar field. So this is the whole chain. This is a feature of nonlinearity of Einstein's equation. So somebody was asking me how he didn't understand the so this is how it goes. And later we will see how you can quantify it in more details, because you have to consider second order quantities, right? So in perturbation theory, what we do is that we consider.
No, it is not clear to me. What is the meaning of the first line? Because first line is basically telling that if you perturb your scalar field, it is basically perturbation of the metric.
Yeah.
But you have written one more statement that is basically nothing but perturbation of the energy momentum tensor as well. This is true, because if you look into the Einstein equation, if you perturb the left side, your right side will automatically perturb.
No, actually, what I'm saying that in the energy momentum tensor itself, it is coupled. I mean, there is something G mu nu is hanging around, right? G mu nu hanging around. So that will actually. So perturbation of the metric will actually come into come there.
Hanging around where? When you are writing your equation, field equation, there is a T mu nu. If you perturb, that will be delta T mu nu.
Yeah, but when you are considering scalar field, you will so your Lagrangian will be given in terms of G mu nu, right?
Anything.
Yeah.
Okay. But you are saying that in T mu nu itself there is a G mu nu.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because there is millimeter coupled, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that is worse.
Then
it will actually affect the energy momentum tensor perturbation as well. So
okay.
Okay, yeah. So in perturbation, what we do that the perturbed quantities, they are function of time and space both, and so they are perturbed around the background. The background quantity, if you average over, so they only depend on time. So what it means that, it's a mathematical thing, I will skip. Full line element is given by the next line that, okay, fine. If we have a perturbation, then what should be the total metric? Okay. Next. Yeah. So next is that, suppose our metric is perturbed. So how should we represent this, right? So this is the most general form of the perturbed metric dynamic that can be written. Okay, so it was actually done long back ago by E.M. Lipschitz in 1946, I think. So I will try to explain each and every term. So let me start with the 0,0 component. So the first term on the right hand side, 1 plus 2 5 5. So this is a scalar perturbation, and after that there is a B comma I, and BIT is there. So this B is a vector perturbation. So actually what you are doing, you are taking a vector and then you are decomposing it into like, how can you make a vector out of scalar? So you, what you do, you just what do I say?
You take the gradient of the scalar. You take the gradient of the scalar.
Yeah. So actually, yeah. So this is how you can write the vector perturbations. Then the last line is the tensor perturbation. So actually, what is that? So I will tell you in the next slide. So it's very, it's not so that. So your tensor perturbation as well can be decomposed into.
Somebody is asking question.
Yeah.
I think I missed something. I'm not sure. Why are we perturbing the metric?
Why
are we perturbing this metric?
Why are we perturbing this metric?
Yeah.
I mean, we are considering perturbation, linear perturbation. So these are the part. So you have the backbone.
He's asking why we need to perturb that all.
Why? Like, what is it we are trying to do by perturbing it?
So there is a motivation that will come later. I will tell you. Okay, why is that? But the thing is that I told you that this whole equation, they are invariant under some coordinate transformation. Okay, so
this is nothing to do with coordinate transformation. Anything. What is the motivation for which we perturb a metric in cosmology?
What is the motivation? So this is like, we study how these perturbations, this small perturbations actually grow or decay. That's how we do in Newtonian thing as well. I think the same thing, motivation.
You are not saying the motivation, you are saying the consequences. I'm asking, what is the motivation?
Why we are just perturbing things?
Yeah.
So if something, we have only background thing, so how thing will change? Everything will be constant. See, something is happening, so physically, if you think why this temperature and anisotropy is there, there should be some perturbations present, otherwise that everything would have been constant, smooth, nice background thing. So that is not the case. I mean, if you see around, you will see perturbations everywhere, right? There are galaxies, there are voids, so there should be some perturbations, otherwise how structures will form. I mean, that's how I understand. I do not know.
So is this perturbation like sort of emergence of large scale structures from
emergence of large scale, it's like
the late time, it will grow with time and include more non-linearities and large scale structures.
This is only linear thing.
And what are we trying to describe here by using perturbation to the metric? The back reaction.
Yes.
I don't know. Wants to explain
that. So the back reaction of the of these perturbation on the background.
Okay. The background scalar field.
Background means the DC term matrix.
Okay.
The DC. Anything?
Yeah. Please continue. Thank you.
So you see that due to this perturbation, he actually have the cross elements. In DC term metric, it is basically a diagonal metric. But if you perturb it, you will see that there are some mixing terms, which are the off-diagonal terms of the metric, okay, which is appearing. So he actually trying to write down this perturbation in terms of scalar, vector, and tensor. And this tensor is basically transverse, stressless, spin two object. Vector is spin one. And he had written this vector as a gradient of the scalar modes, whatever he got. And the scalar one, which people used to call it the curvature perturbation.
Okay.
So in observation, we can able to see scalar, particularly the amplitude of the two-point correlation function and the momentum dependence of the two-point correlation function, which is called the spectral tilt or spectral index, which will tell that your power spectrum is exactly scale invariant or is there is any deviation from that, or maybe higher order runnings that will actually specify the power spectrum and the characteristics of the power spectrum in like with respect to the momentum scale k. And for the tensor modes also, we can able to calculate the two-point correlation function for the tensor modes. But the problem is, till now in observation, you can't able to see those signatures very well. You just know that there is some parameter which is basically measuring the amplitude, the ratio of the amplitude of the tensor spectrum by scalar spectrum, which is some 0.004 or something like that. So you know just the upper limit, but you can't able to detect from the data right now. But if you can able to detect, then it is very interesting, because that actually tells you that in which scale the inflation is occurring. That means which particular background physics, maybe like some particle physics scenario or maybe some string theory scenario or whatever, which one is responsible for inflation, then you can able to say that. But till now we can actually give models, but we can't say that which model is responsible. That's the problem.
Okay.
Yeah. Proceed.
Yeah. So what Sanjay was telling me, the same thing, that we have 10 degrees of freedom of the metric. It has been decomposed into scalars, vectors, and tensors. So fine.
The problem with the vector mode is, if you see the time evolution, you will see that your vector modes will decay.
Yeah.
So you can't actually see particularly the vector modes. But if your vector modes is coupled with the scalar field, then you something called, people used to call it primordial magnetic field. There people used to see the signatures. But yeah, particularly vector modes, it decays with time. So people are not very much interested in the vector modes as far as inflationary physics is concerned. But the tensor modes and scalar modes, these modes are very, very important.
Next, in the similar way, we can decompose the right-hand side of the Einstein equation as shown in this slide. So everything is, yeah. So
you have written your energy momentum tensor as a perfect fluid, and you are perturbing your perfect fluid component by component.
Yes. I am not considering the anisotropic stress here. So I have only isotropic part, the pressure part. For the inflation universe.
So that means in your metric, in the perturbed metric, in the time component as well as in the other component, you have the same A.
Yeah.
That means the, which is people call Bardeen potential.
Yeah. It's actually interesting. So what I was saying about, okay, so actually why should I consider this constructing, suppose this whatever we are measuring, that should not depend on coordinates. So if you see all these perturbations, this scalar, vectors, or tensor, they actually all of them transform as you transform coordinates. So that is why it is important to form something which does not transform if you transform the coordinates. So then how do you
are talking about the diffeomorphism?
Yeah, so actually diffeom, it's I don't want to go to the diffeomorphism.
Yeah, so this is basically diffeomorphic transformation.
Yeah. So diffeomorphism is like, okay, fine, I don't want to talk about it. Yeah, so under the transformation, this as I said that you put this in the old metric and you put this on the new metric, you will find out that this is how the perturbations they transform under the coordinate transformation. So but as I told today, that okay, fine, we should find something which does not transform at all, because whatever you are physically measuring, that should not depend on the coordinates. So that is what was did by James Bodin. So he actually, so there are many you can you can find infinite number of gauge invariant variables. So these are the two simplest kind of variables which most people use, because in this in new longitudinal gauge, when you put this B and E, so these two parts, if you go back to the this thing, your scalar part of the your vector perturbations, and this E part, where is that E part is here, right? Yeah. So if you put these two, so actually what you do, your equation of motion in GR, they are independent of gauge transformation. So there is a freedom lurking around. So you need to fix that freedom. So by fixing gauge, what you do, you put some constant beforehand, so that there is no ambiguity in solving the equations. I mean, everything is consistent. Suppose people choose gauges depending on the situation, just like the case of electrodynamics. Depending on different problem, you choose different gauges. So in the same thing, here you also choose. I did all the calculations in a longitudinal gauge, because this is the simplest kind of gauge where the metric perturbations and the gauge invariant variables, they coincide. So when you consider your equations, you just have to just substitute. You can just work with your metric variables, nothing will change. This is one of the nicest things of this gauge invariant equation of motion, or whatever you are saying. So this equation 34. So actually it's a weak calculation. I've just mentioned here. Okay, so this is how. So suppose you are starting with this action, and you are giving the equation of motion, and you are defining this whole thing as pi mu equals zero. So when you
What is pi mu nu?
Pi mu nu is the whole thing. I mean, the equation, if there was matter, suppose there are matter, okay, because I didn't put in, so you put g mu nu if r minus t mu nu equals zero. The whole thing, you put the whole thing equals zero.
That means the constraint equation.
Yeah. So expand the above quantity, it's a big calculation only. So metric perturbations, and especially average it, so you will get this kind of thing. So and it was shown in Abram Brandner, this reference, that this whole quantity actually remains gauge invariant. Okay, so your effective energy momentum tensor, the perturbations, actually remains invariant. So next we try to calculate the effective energy momentum tensor perturbations, which is actually the gravitational waves around a flat space. So if as you know, this eta mu nu is your constant, it's a background which is flat, which is not curved. So these are the quantities you can calculate from the given perturbations, and you get this equation of motion here. So if you see equation 41, so you will see this is the linearist equation in R plus alpha square model in flat space, not in curved space, in flat space. So you can see that there are higher derivative terms. So which are the higher derivative terms? If you see the second term and the third term, so del mu is there, and delta R itself is the second derivative of the metric perturbations. So you are actually fourth order. This equation is a fourth order equation. So how do you solve whatever equation you know in physics? It actually second order differential equation. So how do you solve a fourth order differential equation? So this is the problem. This is the generic problem with the higher derivative gravity theories. And as I saw today earlier, that okay, fine, the trace of the field equation is given by this. Now we'll do one thing. We will redefine the perturb variable in this way so that we can get rid of these higher derivative terms, right? So that whatever equations and put the Lorentz gauge condition, this whole thing, this equation 41, that will simplify to these two equations, which will not contain the higher derivative terms. And it has, this 45 and 46, these two equations are actually solutions, these are wavelife solutions, okay? So the 46 is the wave equation for the actual Ricci mode. So actually, this is the new degree of freedom entering into your theory itself in the flat space itself. So the 47 is the usual gravitational wave solution. So you can actually show that your FR theory, at least in your theory in flat space, it actually shows the existence of gravitational waves. So there are some remaining degrees of freedom you have to transform. So I'm not discussing it. I'm just giving you the points that the whole one of my main goals of this thesis was to decompose, redefine the perturb variable so that we can get rid of these higher derivative terms, then calculate the so once you are done with the higher derivative terms in the linearized field equation, you can go on to calculate the energy moment and tensor of gravitational waves in the following way. So you are, so as described earlier, that we can find this curly g mu nu is the whole thing, whatever the modified field equation you have, the background part, the perturb part, the second order perturbation part, and when you average over it. Now averaging is also a problematic thing in GR. So this averaging is done for low frequency, high frequency wave. So it's a short wave approximation. So it's this thing is not actually doesn't work in inflationary universe, because you have super horizon perturbations as well. So where the length of the perturbation is much larger than your background. So whatever I was doing here, I had to take care of that thing as well. So I didn't have the opportunity to do that, but there are prescriptions. So I was thinking about that, how to take average of all those things. Still, if you do the calculations, this is nice, simple looking thing, but the calculation is very cumbersome. I mean, it's very weak calculation. That's it. I mean, next thing is that I was working with this equation. So this is actually the equation in for the curved space. So where you can find that this is not so easy looking equation what you had in flat space. So I was trying to redefine the perturbed variable so that we can get, I can get rid of the higher derivative terms in the linearized and modified equation and get the perturbations, then do the same thing for the scalar perturbations, but I was not unable. I have done up to this. So this is my discussion at this point. It is not clear whatever was the answers given by the Berry and Gear for the flat space, will it work for tensor perturbation? I'm not sure about it right now, because the calculations are very cumbersome and it's not that easier, and it is even more non-trivial for the scalar perturbations. So in this whole talk, I have talked about gauge invariant effective energy momentum tensor due to supervisor modified gravity equation. So I don't know, that's it. Thank you. I mean, if you have any questions, I will try to answer.
So anybody have any question? Anjun. Shattoki.
Hello.
Yeah.
I may have a question, but it may be very trivial.
No, it's okay.
So around equation 34, can you go back there?
Yeah.
So here the metric, there is a metric, right? So where? Is that still the FRW metric?
Where is that metric?
In 33, you can see 33. Yeah, 33.
Yeah. I mean, this is. Whatever, so, if you put the components there.
For general metric.
This is a general metric.
Okay. Then it's okay. Because like you said that we can put matter there, right? But I don't think it's
matter
okay
there,
to put.
I mean, what you were doing that, you were taking everything on the left hand side and you were putting it to zero.
Okay.
Nothing. I'm telling you that, okay, fine, you have something equation, left hand side equal to right hand side. Okay, you just take your right hand side to your left hand side and take the whole thing as zero. That's what I have done. Nothing more than that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anjun?
No, that's okay.
Shattuki?
Sir.
Any question?
No, sir.
Tapore, who are the other people? Please, if you want to ask, you can ask. There is no issue. No question. Everybody have understood everything. So if not, then we thank the speaker for giving the talk. And next week, Shattuki will give the seminar. Next week, Shattuki is the speaker. He will talk about his project.